Grace and peace, friends. Pastor Tiffany here with another midweek Lenten poetic and artistic reflection. We're coming up on the fourth Sunday in Lent, and our questions are getting a little more intense, a little more complicated. This week, we'll hear an extended passage from the Gospel of John, a story where Jesus miraculously restores sight to a blind man. But before he cures him of his blindness, his disciples want to know, who sinned, this man or his parents? As we unpack this passage, we'll see that we have much to learn about our own projections and judgments and assumptions that we might make about physical ability or mental illness, which is the topic that inspired a poem for this week, a poem by Reverend Sarah Speed that she calls Jesus in the Psych Ward. He's in group therapy, plastic chairs in a circle, paper cups with weak coffee. Everyone in the room has seeking eyes. The Pharisees admitted him. They said things like, he's more than we can handle. They let the rumors fly. The other patients like him. They say, he listens to me. He calls them by name. And when one of them asks, is this our fault? Are we here because we sinned? Jesus does not wait for the facilitator to speak. He crosses the circle. He kneels down. He grabs their hands in his and says, child of the covenant, God loves you too much to ever wish you pain. Bodies and minds crumble sometimes, but God's love for you does not. And after that, there were happy tears, and the group was dismissed to lunch, where they broke bread, and no one talked of sin. And we also have two thought-provoking pieces of art to consider this week. The first, by the Reverend T. Denise Anderson, is called Sunrise, and it's oil on canvas. Here's the artist's statement. Jesus's community saw this man's blindness as a curse or a punishment for sin, either his parents' sin or his own. While it's true that blindness comes with challenges in a world made for sightedness, it's important that we do not problematize blindness in preaching and teaching the story the way that they did. What happened here was an apocalypse, a revelation of the nature of Jesus and the heart and mind of God. That revelation challenged the epistemologies of the community, and it is the ones in the story who'd been sighted all along who were ironically unable to perceive what God was doing. Jesus says that he must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Daybreak is also an apocalypse of sorts. It reveals what we couldn't readily see at night and allows us to perceive the work in front of us. In my portrait, I've lit this man's face as if the earth and the sun's light are moving slowly across the surface, signaling the dawn of a new day. His eyes remain closed in my portrait because, for me, his newfound sightedness is not the miracle or the most important part of this story. What's most important is the revelation of who Jesus is. Jesus has been revealed to this man in a way that even the witnesses around him could not comprehend. His encounter with Jesus raises him to a new life and offers the whole community a new understanding of God's works. It's a new day for everyone, though that proves to be a difficult gift to receive. Our second piece of art is called Insight by Reverend Liesl Gwyn Geraghty. This is a silk painting with digital drawing and collage. And you can see the varied elements there. They are as varied as the many questions that come up in the second part of this story of Jesus restoring this blind man's sight. Listen to the artist's statement. In seven verses, the gospel writer tells us that a man born blind is given sight. But after that, the narrator devotes 33 verses to the details of the disagreements that swell after the healing takes place. I used to find the second part of the story tedious and exhausting. In a world with constant conflict, I'm tired of listening to endless bickering. However, this second half of the story makes me realize this encounter is hardly about physical healing or literal blindness. It's about how harmful theology can prevent us from seeing people, truly seeing them. It's about how our narrow imagination can harden into accusation and blame. It's about how we can be threatened by new ideas or shifts in someone's identity. It's about how doctrine can lead to exile. Ultimately, it's a story about our resistance to change. Can it be a cautionary tale for us? In this image, hands expressing denial and exclusion press in on the man. In the background, I wrote a barrage of questions I imagine emerging from the crowd. Why did God heal you? What did you do to cause this? Who sinned? Alongside those questions, I wove in contemporary statements I've heard spoken in situations when we think a tidy rationale will comfort us. Everything happens for a reason. God only gives you as much as you can handle. Pray harder. I wonder what this story would look like had better questions been asked. What if his neighbors had instead asked the blind man, "How do you feel?" What if the man had asked the crowd, "What are you afraid of?" What if the Pharisees had asked one another, "What if it's time to change?" Surrounded by remnants of narrow vision, the man has new insight. He looks beyond the words, beyond the crowd, beyond the accusations, driving him out of town. Can we seek understanding without denigrating or objectifying humans in the process? There we have it. Two images to pray with our eyes. So many questions to open our minds and our ears. Peace be with you as you prepare for this fourth Sunday in Lent.